Hello friends, welcome to Unacademy. Let's crack NEET PG. I'm Dr. Sonali Chandra, and in today's session, we will be talking about evaluation of male infertility. I have highlighted my reference code here, that is SHONALI. So if you take a plus subscription using this code, then you can avail a 10% discount on your subscription. India's largest learning platform, that is what is Unacademy. If you get a plus subscription, you will get access to unlimited live and recorded sessions from India's best educators. You will get daily live classes where you can interact with your educator, ask your doubts and queries, and get them solved there and then. So it's like a live classroom experience. The courses are structured keeping in line with the latest NEET PG syllabus. There are live tests and quizzes which will evaluate your performance as you go. And most importantly, one subscription gives you unlimited access. So you can watch all the live sessions from all of the faculties who are on the platform. And even if you miss out on the live sessions, you can always go back and watch the recorded versions from the comfort of your own devices. Top educators are associated with the platform, like Dr. Nikita Nanwani, Dr. Mohammad Azam, Dr. Preeti Sharma, Dr. Devesh Mishra sir for pathology. All 19 subjects which we need to prepare for the NEET PG examination are covered in the platform, and every now and then concise and comprehensive batch courses and crash courses, they keep getting launched on the platform. So you can check out the ongoing courses in the platform as well. And as far as the subscription packages go, you can choose any package depending upon your need and requirement. So for crash courses, for the most recent upcoming examinations, you can take the 3-month and 6-month subscription. And for those of you who are targeting the next year mid-year exams, you can take the 12-month subscription. It will give you ample time to go through all of the sessions and will leave you enough time in the end to revise as well. And it turns out to be more economical in the longer run, ₹2,083 per month. And for those of you who are wanting a slower pace of preparation because you're in their third year or final year MBBS and are still juggling hospital schedules and duties and classes at the same time, then you can take the 24-month subscription. It turns out to be far more economical in the longer run, ₹1,250 per month around. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you can avail a 10% discount on your subscription package as well. So coming back to the session at hand for today, where we will be talking about evaluation of male infertility. All right. Now, what I will be talking about in this session, good evening, Vinita. Good evening, Prabhat. Both of you, I welcome. I can see that you've joined in. So in this evaluation, we're going to be talking about the very basics. Okay, I'll briefly talk about the causes which we need to look at while evaluating male infertility. I'll talk about the semen analysis. What is normal semen analysis? What is abnormal semen analysis? And what do we do when we do find an abnormal semen analysis? So that evaluation is what we are going to cover. And then in the end, I will be comprehensively telling you about the indications which are usually used for intrauterine insemination and IVF. So this is broadly what we are going to discuss in today's session. Okay. So hi, Dr. Musarrat. Welcome. Welcome. So let's begin. Now, male causes are a very frequent cause of infertility in a couple. Now, male causes can contribute to about 20 to 40% of the cases overall. And it could also be the only cause or the sole cause in about 20% of infertile couples as well. Now, I have in the inset, you can see the diagram of the male internal genital structures. So let's just go briefly through that. So we know that these sperms, they are produced in the testes. Okay. From the testes, they go into the epididymis. And in the epididymis, that is where they are stored. And that is where the motility of the sperms is gained. So the motility is gained in the epididymis. They are produced in the testes. That's important. And one important thing to note about this is that spermatogenesis takes place at a lower temperature than the normal core body temperature. And that's the reason why testes are located outside the body in the scrotum, right? So spermatogenesis need a lower temperature than the core body temperature. So that's an important point to note here. And that can help you understand why in certain occupations, the risk of having infertility in males increases. Like for example, if a male works in the blast furnace, right? So in any occupational environments where the male is exposed to higher temperatures, those are some of the occupations which are associated with a decreased fertility in the male, right? Now then this epididymis further advances and moves on to the vas deferens, which is the traveling pathway for the semen and the sperms. Now vas deferens, now sperms travels via the vas deferens and then into the ejaculatory duct here. Now the seminal vesicle is another important part of the male internal genital structure, right? Seminal vesicle secretions, they make up the bulk of the semen, and that seminal vesicle secretions are instilled into the semen via the seminal vesicle duct. So once the vas deferens fuses with the seminal vesicle duct here, it joins together to form the ejaculatory duct. And then the ejaculatory duct opens into the penile urethra. And then from the penile urethra, ejaculation is going to take place via the penis. So this is the pathway that the sperms take. Okay, now the important thing to note here is also the fact that just like the ovarian function or the production of the oocyte and the egg is under the control of the hypothalamus and pituitary, so is spermatogenesis. Spermatogenesis is also under the control of hypothalamus and pituitary in the male. So the hypothalamus again is going to release GnRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone. It is going to act on the anterior pituitary and luteinizing hormone and FSH hormone is going to be released in the males as well. Right? And these hormones are then going to act on the Sertoli cells as well on the Leydig cells. So predominantly the LH hormone acts on the Leydig cells and the Leydig cells in turn produce testosterone. Right? And the FSH acts on the Sertoli cells predominantly, and Sertoli cells are the supporting cells along which the spermatogenesis takes place, right? So spermatogenesis requires a good hypothalamic, a proper hypothalamic pituitary axis, a functional hypothalamic pituitary and testicular axis here. So just like in the females, the males are also governed by their hypothalamus and pituitary and response of these hormones. And in response of these hormones, spermatogenesis is supported and it is progressing. Okay. So now you can understand here also that as far as the causes of male infertility are concerned, the causes of male infertility can also be at the level of the testes. So the testicular production of sperms could be inhibited because of a primary testicular failure, or there could be a problem at the level of hypothalamus and pituitary. So there could be a central cause, there could be a pre-testicular cause that we call it as pre-testicular cause, which leads to reduction in the LH and FSH hormones, and therefore the spermatogenesis could be inhibited. Or there could be an obstruction in this outflow tract anywhere, maybe an epididymis obstruction, maybe a vas deferens obstruction, maybe an ejaculatory duct obstruction. So there could be obstruction in this pathway as well, and that could lead to decreased release of sperms in the ejaculate. So the causes of male infertility can also be broadly divided as testicular causes of infertility, there can be pre-testicular causes of infertility, or there could be post-testicular causes of infertility as well, right? So let us briefly understand what these causes are. So when we talk about the causes of male infertility, mind you, the most common cause is most of the times we end up finding no significant reason for the male infertility. Majority of the times, in 40 to 50% cases, it is idiopathic. We do not identify any testicular, any pre-testicular, post-testicular. No definite cause is identified in most of the cases, right? And after that, the second most common cause of male infertility is gonadal failure. Right? After idiopathic, the second most common cause is gonadal failure, which is responsible for male infertility in about 30 to 40% cases. Now, what are the causes of this gonadal failure? The causes of gonadal failure could be congenital or they could be acquired causes, right? Now, in the congenital causes of gonadal failure, a male could be suffering from Klinefelter syndrome, which is an extra X chromosome in the male, XXY, right? So, Klinefelter syndrome is one of an important cause of congenital gonadal failure. There could also be Y chromosome microdeletions in the male, which are responsible for gonadal failure. And as far as the acquired causes of gonadal failure are concerned, there are many. The simple ones here, you can see that there could be some history of testicular trauma that has led to ischemia and necrosis of the testes. There could be history of radiation exposure that is responsible for gonadal failure. There could be cryptorchidism, that is called as undescended testes. So I told you that testicular production of sperms, spermatogenesis, need a lower temperature. So the testes needs to be in their normal location inside the scrotum to allow for proper spermatogenesis. Now, if the testes are undescended meaning that they could be anywhere along the tract of descent. They could be intra-abdominal testes or they could be in the inguinal canal. So wherever they are, if they're undescended, then there are chances that there could be associated male infertility because of that reason. Varicoceles is a condition where there is a dilatation of the pampiniform plexus of veins which are draining the testes. Now, varicoceles have been associated with the male infertility because the enlargement of the pampiniform plexus of the veins, it raises the temperature around the testes, and that is cited as one contributing cause for male infertility if a male suffers from varicoceles, right? And then childhood infections like mumps. Mumps infection can also affect the testes and lead to mumps or chytis, and that is another cause of gonadal failure in the males. Tuberculosis is another important cause of gonadal failure in a case of tropical countries like India. Tuberculosis is also an important cause, especially the genitourinary tuberculosis. So genitourinary tuberculosis in the males can also be an acquired cause of gonadal failure, right? So whenever I find a male with infertility and evidence of gonadal failure, I start thinking in terms of whether it could be a congenital gonadal failure or there could be a possible acquired cause concerning this gonadal failure. Now, the third most common cause of male infertility that is identified is disorders in sperm transport. So somewhere along the path, there is obstruction, right? So that is what we call as disorders in sperm transport, which are responsible for about 10 to 20% cases of male infertility. And disorders in sperm transport, we are going to broadly consider them under these headings. So there could be a congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, right? So if the vas deferens is absent, right? If the vas deferens is absent, then there is no connecting link between the epididymis and the ejaculatory duct. And therefore, there will be disordered sperm transport. The sperms will never be able to reach the ejaculatory duct at all. So congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens is one condition that I'm going to elaborate upon. There could be primary ciliary dyskinesia. Primary ciliary dyskinesia is a genetic disorder where the cilia in the body are not functioning properly. The cilia are immotile, right? So this is also called as the immotile cilia syndrome. Another name for it is the cartilaginous syndrome. So men who are suffering from primary ciliary dyskinesia or cartilaginous syndrome, they have been seen to have decreased sperm motility, and the transport of sperms into from the genital tract of the male is disordered there. So that is one reason there. There could be an acquired infection like tuberculosis and gonorrhea, which is responsible for causing contracture of the male genital tract, right? So there could be an infective cause. There could be scarring because of these infections in the genital tract, in the transport of the genital tract. So these are again going to be able to cause decrease in sperm transport. And then there could be surgical causes for disorders in sperm transport. One of the surgical causes, if I give you an example, would be, let's say a male got operated for a varicocele, right? A male got operated for a varicocele or cryptorchidism, and then during the surgery there was accidental ligature or accidental trauma to the vas deferens. So any surgery in the genital tract leading to an accidental ligature or trauma to the vas deferens, ligature or trauma to the vas deferens, could be responsible for obstruction in the genital tract. So these are the disorders, important disorders, which we tend to identify when there is a post-testicular cause of male infertility. And then there are less common causes. Mostly these three causes are identified in that order. And the less common causes of male infertility are hypothalamic or pituitary cause, contributing to only about 1-2% of the causes of male infertility. Ejaculatory dysfunction. Ejaculatory dysfunction could be retrograde ejaculation, could be, impotence could be a reason for the male infertility as well. These are less common causes, right? Now, ejaculatory dysfunction and impotence, it could be psychogenic or it could be drug induced as well. It could be psychogenic or it could be drug induced as well. So broadly, these are the causes of male infertility. My focus is going to be on the gonadal failure and the disorders of sperm transport, because these are more common causes. And yes, of course, please do not forget, in the majority of circumstances, we are not able to identify any cause. So the most common cause in 40-50% cases is idiopathic. So moving on further, how do we evaluate a male with infertility? How do we evaluate the male partner for infertility? It has to begin with the history, and the history has to deal with identifying the risk factors, right? So all of these causes which are discussed here, they can be ruled out on the history as well. So that is what we need to figure out. So any history of smoking should be looked into. A male who is trying to conceive should be advised that smoking decreases the sperm motility and also the sperm count, all right, all the sperm numbers in the semen. So history of smoking should be looked into, and should be advised that smoking should be stopped when efforts to conceive are on play. Occupational history is again important, like I told you. So if we identify men who are suffering from, if we identify male partners who are suffering from infertility, and we found out that they are working, glass factories or blast furnace factories, or they are long distance lorry drivers, for instance, where prolonged sitting and driving over long distances required, or sometimes even tight scrotal support, which lifts up the scrotum and the testes consequently near to the abdomen. So these are the important factors that you should also consider, and then you should tell the male preventive methods for the same. So occupational history is also important in identifying the male partner with infertility there. History of sexual dysfunction should be looked into, it should be asked. History of sexually transmitted diseases should be sought and asked. So there could be a past history of tuberculosis, past history of gonorrhea, past history of chlamydia, that should be looked into. Prior surgical history should also be asked. maybe the man has undergone a history or surgery for cryptorchidism in childhood, or has recently undergone a varicocele repair. So these would be pointers in the direction that yes, maybe there could be an obstruction or ligation of the vas deferens as a complication of those surgical procedures. So prior surgical history becomes important. Again, drug history, sometimes, you know, a simple evaluation of the drug history is very, very important. One of the drugs which are often included in causing decreased sperm count and sperm motility, and also implicated in causing impotence and ejaculatory dysfunction, are the alpha blockers, which are often used as antihypertensive medications. So drug history should also be sought out, and any history of chronic illness should also be looked into as a contributory factor for male infertility, right? So the evaluation of male infertility begins with a proper history. Okay, so we have to look into the history to identify the potential causes. And a very basic evaluation, which is a very simple evaluation, is the semen analysis, right? So the semen analysis is the primary analysis which we do to evaluate for male infertility. So these are the two things that are done in the first visit itself. So in the first visit, when on one hand we are evaluating the female causes of infertility, the same sitting we are also looking into the history of the male partner, and we are also ordering a semen analysis sample. Now let's talk about the semen analysis, right? Now semen analysis, the most important thing to note is that how to collect the sample of the semen. And it is important for us to know about the collection of sample, because we are the people who are going to give directions to the male partner as to how to go about collecting the semen sample. Now it is important to advise the male partner that the semen sample should be collected after an abstinence of about 2 to 3 days. Okay, so it should be collected after a period of abstinence. So you have to tell the male partner and the female partner, both of them together, that abstain from intercourse for 3 days and then come and give the semen sample, right? You will also help to tell the male partner very specifically that for these 3 days also avoid masturbation, right? Now that's important. Why? Because if for example the male gives the semen sample, yesterday he had sex or yesterday he masturbated and today he came and gave the semen sample, then there could be a falsely low count. If the duration of this abstinence is short, if the duration of this abstinence is short, the semen sample report could come out to be showing falsely low counts. Falsely low sperm count could be seen. And let's say, for example, if the duration of this abstinence is too long, if the duration of this abstinence is more than 7 days, if the duration of this abstinence is more than 7 days, then it could lead to a semen analysis report showing falsely high count of dead sperms. All right, so this is important to note here, that for a proper semen analysis, it is important that the sample is collected after an abstinence of 3 days, not more than 7 days at least, and not even too short a duration of abstinence should be there. Okay, the next important thing to note is that the husband is asked to go for the collection of semen sample in the lab itself. So sometimes men ask, you know, that can I get the semen sample after collecting it from home? No, ideally it should be collected in the lab itself, because the semen, when the sample is submitted, needs to be analyzed immediately, right? Because you know that once the semen is ejaculated, it immediately undergoes liquefaction. So we need to evaluate the semen before that liquefaction happens. So it should be ideally collected in the lab itself. And the another thing, important thing, you have to advise him that he has to collect the sample by masturbation, and it has to be collected in a sterile container which is provided for. All right, so a latex condom, usually condoms are latex condoms, so latex condom samples, they are to be discouraged. So it's not not like the husband can, you know, come from home and get his semen sample collected in a condom and give it to you. No, he has to collect it in the lab, in a sterile container by masturbation, and has to be collected after an abstinence of 3 days. Now, once the semen sample will be analyzed under the microscope by the embryologist, we will get to have a semen analysis report. So, what are the normal semen parameters? And then this is very, very important. Why is this very, very important? Because direct questions from this are asked in your NEET PG examination. What are the normal semen parameters, right? So let's go ahead. The normal semen parameter is a pH. Now the pH of the semen should be alkaline, okay? It should not be acidic. If it is acidic, then that is abnormal. So normal semen is alkaline in nature. The volume of the semen should at least be more than 1.5 ml, right? The count of the sperms in the ejaculate should at least be more than 39 million. Usually, the sperm count is about 60 to 120 million per ejaculate, right? So that is what I say when I say count. Count should at least be more than 39 million per ejaculate. And when I talk about the sperm concentration, when I say sperm concentration, that means how many sperms are present in per ml of the ejaculate, right? So the sperm concentration should at least be more than 15 million per ml, okay? Then the motility is also checked. A total motility should at least be of more than 40%. So at least 40% of the sperms in the semen sample should be motile. And at least 32% of those sperms should have a progressive forward motility. And there should at least be 4% of normal morphological forms, right? So that is extremely important. About 58% or at least 58% of the sperm should be vital. They should be viable. They should be alive, right? And the WBC count in the semen sample should be less than 1 million per ml. If the WBC count is more, then that means that there could be an underlying infection and that needs to be evaluated. So WBC count is also important. Now, out of all of these semen parameters, which are the most important while making decisions and which are the ones you should remember definitely? So the concentration should be more than 15 ml. That is very, very important. It's a very important parameter. The sperm concentration. Motility should be more than 40%. Again, a very important parameter to remember. And forward motility should at least be more than 32%. Again, a very, very important parameter to remember. And morphology should be more than 4%. Normal morphological form should be there. Again, a very, very important parameter to remember. So out of all of these parameters, the most important ones are concentration, motility, especially progressive forward motility, and a normal morphology. Now that's extremely, extremely important. Now, normally when we get a semen analysis report, it's not going to be that only the sperm count is less, only the sperm concentration is less, only the motility is less and rest everything is normal, or only the morphological forms are abnormal. So usually you get a combination of abnormalities, right? And as far as the combination of abnormalities is considered, we need to focus upon the concentration, the motility, and the morphology. But yes, in your NEET PG exam, they do ask you what is the most important criteria among all. And if you have to choose one, then the most important criteria is morphology followed by motility. Morphology is overall the most important criteria followed by motility, right? So remember when I was having a discussion on the understanding fertility, the first session when I took, and I told you that the sperms, they have to be motile because they have to gain access to the fallopian tubes, right? And then they should also gain the hypermotility, and then they should have a normal morphology for that reason, a normal tail, a normal mitochondria, normal nucleus. They should have a normal acrosomal cap. And the importance of this acrosomal cap was that it was helping in drilling the sperm into the zona pellucida. For that, we needed the acrosomal reaction to take place. So the sperm function or the capacity of the sperm to fertilize is directly dependent upon the sperm being morphologically normal, right? So this morphology, the morphology of the sperm, the morphology of the sperm, it reflects the capacity to fertilize. It in turn reflects the capacity of the sperm to fertilize. All right, it is a reflection of the sperm function, and therefore it is the most important criteria. Please remember that if morphology is not given the option, then you can choose motility as the answer. So the most important criteria, first best morphology, second best motility, right? Now how is this morphology of the sperm assessed? The morphology of the sperm is assessed under the microscope, right? And a criteria is used for assessing the sperm morphology. What is this criteria called as? This is called as the strict criteria. Direct question, one liner asked in your PG examination, what is the criteria for assessing sperm morphology? That is called as the strict criteria, that is also known as the Kruger-Tigerberg criteria. Okay, now under this criteria, what happens is that the microscopic evaluation of the sperm is done, and the person or the pathologist or the embryologist who is evaluating the sperm has a look and decides whether the head of the sperm is normally formed, the tail is normally formed, the middle piece where the mitochondria is normally formed, whether the acrosomal cap is normal. So the morphological appearance of the sperm is tested by various standards, which are documented under the strict criteria, also known as the Kruger-Tigerberg criteria. So this is a direct question that they ask in the NEET PG examination, one liner question. So please remember these important points, right? Now, what is the normal semen parameter? So what are the normal semen parameters? What is absence of semen called? Sometimes there could be complete absence of semen. If there is complete absence of semen, that is called as aspermia. That is called as aspermia. Aspermia is what we mean by complete absence of semen only altogether. There can be absence of sperms in the semen. The semen could be there, all right. The ejaculate is there, the semen is there, but the semen does not have any sperms at all. And then that is called as azoospermia. That is called as azoospermia. Sometimes there could be oligospermia. Oligospermia means decreased sperm count. Oligospermia means sperm count, sperm concentration less than 15 million per ml. Okay, so sperm concentration less than 15 million per ml is oligospermia. What is severe oligospermia? Severe oligospermia means sperm concentration that is less than 5 million per ml. So if the sperm concentration is less than 5 million per ml, we call it as severe oligospermia. If there is decreased motility of the sperms, we call it as asthenospermia. Asthenic means weakness. So weakness in motility, so decreased motility is called as asthenospermia. Okay, we can also have abnormal morphological forms. So normally the number of or the percentage of morphologically normal forms should at least be more than 4%. If there are higher number of abnormal morphological forms, then that is called as teratospermia. Then that is called as teratospermia. Okay. Then there can be dead sperms in the semen as well. If there are dead sperms in the semen, then that is called as necrospermia. Necro meaning dead. So necrospermia. right? And sometimes there can also be round sperms. Now, round sperms are a globular appearance of the head of the sperms, right? Globular appearance of the head of the sperms that happens because there is no acrosomal cap. Loss of acrosomal cap in the sperms, round sperms, is what we call as globospermia, what we call as globospermia. So all of these abnormal semen parameters can be found. Any of these abnormal semen parameters can be found. So the semen report could come out to be that the male is having oligospermia, or it could come out to be as having asthenospermia, decreased motility, or it could come out as teratospermia, or it could come out as OATS. OATS. What is OATS? OATS is a mnemonic for oligo, astheno, teratospermia. So like I told you, in one report itself, more than one parameter could be abnormal, right? So more than one, it could be just oligoasthenospermia, asthenoteratospermia. So a combination of abnormalities can be there, or a single abnormality might be there. So there can be varieties of abnormal semen parameters. Now, like I told you, most of the times when we get an abnormal semen parameter, we do not generally find any identifiable cause. Most of the times the cause is idiopathic. But yes, we do need to evaluate, or we do need to go for further evaluation, especially in a case of azoospermia or severe oligospermia. If there is azoospermia or severe oligospermia, then definitely the male needs further evaluation, further endocrinological evaluation, to find out what is the cause of such severe oligospermia or azoospermia. So oligospermia means absolutely low sperm concentrations, less than 5 million per ml, and azoospermia means absence of sperms. All right. Now, the evaluation would begin with a history and physical examination. All right. History, again, pertaining to the various causes. Physical examination would include the examination of the testes and the scrotum, digital examination of the scrotal area, digital examination of the inguinal area to look for any abnormality there. So history and physical examination should be done, definitely. Subhash, you want to know abnormal and normal morphology. At least 96% is to 4% is good. So yes, normal morphology form should at least be more than 4%. At least be more than 4%. Okay, so that is the least minimum. Normal report, if you're going to look at, there are many normal morphological forms rather than many abnormal morphological forms. This is the bare minimum. All of these criteria I've told you, at least count should be more than 15 million per ml. At least the motility should be more than 32%. At least normal morphological form should be more than 4%. So these are the bare minimum to label it as normal. Okay? Okay, Subhash? So once we are done with the history and physical examination, it is very important to undergo a hormonal profile. Now, what do we see in this hormonal profile? We see the serum testosterone levels, and we see the serum FSH levels mainly. So these are the two important hormonal tests that we perform in the hormonal profile when the male is showing the report of azoospermia or severe oligospermia. So we can find that the testosterone is decreased and the FSH is increased. If the testosterone is decreased and the FSH is increased, that means that the cause of this azoospermia is, what is this cause of this azoospermia? Afshan, I will talk about that in the management. What would be the course of action if there is severe asthenospermia only, or decreased motility only? What would be the cause if the testosterone is decreased and the FSH is increased? What do you decipher by this hormonal analysis? If the testosterone is decreased and the FSH is increased, that means there is gonadal failure. That means that there is gonadal failure. Okay, and if we identify a male as a gonadal failure, then on examination, he's often found to have shrunken testes. He's often found to have shrunken testes on examination. So if you have a male with azoospermia report on or a severe oligospermia report, a testosterone level that is decreased, an FSH level that is increased, that means the cause is gonadal failure. He's often found to have shrunken testes as well, and it is important in this situation to go for a karyotype. It is important in this situation to go for a karyotype to rule out Klinefelter syndrome, okay? To rule out Klinefelter syndrome. It is important also to test for Y chromosome microdeletions. It is important to test for Y chromosome microdeletions also to find out if they are responsible for the gonadal failure. Okay, and then the other important cause of the azoospermia is the obstructive causes. Now, what we can find out here, what if the hormonal profile shows that both testosterone and FSH is decreased? If both testosterone and FSH both are decreased, that means that the signal from the hypothalamus and pituitary is not coming. That means that there is possibly a hypothalamic or a pituitary cause. Now, this is rare. This is rare to find in the male. Only about 1-2% cases of hypothalamic or pituitary causes of azoospermia are found. This is seen only in about 1-2% of the males. But if the hormone profile shows that the testosterone and FSH is normal, if both the hormones are normal, that means that there could be an obstruction. That means that there could be an obstructive cause of the azoospermia. That means that there could be obstructive azoospermia. And then you will have to rule out obstruction. For that, we undergo a transrectal ultrasound. We undergo a transrectal ultrasound to show, to see if there is any obstruction along the male internal genital tract. So on transrectal ultrasonography, we can find an obstruction, okay? Or we will not find an obstruction, nothing will be found, and we can see that the congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens is there. So in obstruction, what are we going to find? We are going to find that the male internal genitalia, or the duct proximal to the obstruction, the duct proximal to the obstruction is dilated. Okay, and in congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, we are going to simply find on ultrasound that the vas deferens is absent and there is no dilatation of the duct anywhere. Okay, so these are the important things to note. Okay, so if the hormone levels are normal, that means it is obstructive azoospermia. And if there is obstructive azoospermia, you have to find out whether the cause of this obstructive azoospermia is actual obstruction in the genital tract or it is because of congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens. Okay, clear on this? So this is how the evaluation of an azoospermic male is going to proceed. History and physical examination first, hormonal profile next. Based on the hormonal profile, we will be able to categorize the causes of azoospermia as because of gonadal failure. If there's gonadal failure, the testosterone is going to be decreased and FSH will be increased. If we do find gonadal failure as the cause, it is important to perform a karyotype of the male to rule out Klinefelter syndrome, and it is also important to test for Y chromosome microdeletions. If both are decreased, then the cause is at the level of the hypothalamus and the pituitary. And if the hormones are absolutely normal, then we call it as obstructive azoospermia. Alright, now the next important thing to note here is, again, there can be also a variety of other semen analysis reports. So let's have a look at this semen report. And this is again very, very important because questions are asked from this report as well. Questions are asked around this scenario as well. So let's evaluate the semen report. Azoospermia, low volume ejaculate, acidic pH, and absent fructose. what are the possible causes of this semen analysis report? Azoospermia means no sperms in the semen. Okay, no sperms are there. Low volume ejaculate. Normally the volume is more than 1.5 ml. If the volume of the ejaculate is very, very low, I told you that the bulk of the semen volume, the bulk of the semen volume is coming from the seminal vesicles, okay? And it is the seminal vesicle secretions which are responsible for the alkaline pH. Secretions from these vesicles, seminal vesicle secretions, they are responsible for the alkaline pH of the semen. So if the pH of the semen is acidic, okay, acidic secretions come from the prostatic glands. So if the semen report says that the sample is acidic in nature, that means there is some problem at the level of the seminal vesicles, right? Absent fructose. It is the seminal vesicle secretions which are rich in fructose. So fructose in the semen sample also comes from the seminal vesicles. So if this is the report, then there can be two glaring possibilities. The two immediately glaring possibilities are, have a look at here on the diagram in the inset. The possibility could be that there is an obstruction of the ejaculatory duct. If there is an obstruction of the ejaculatory duct here, then the seminal vesicle secretions which are supposed to enter into the ejaculatory duct, they are not able to enter. The sperms that are supposed to enter the ejaculatory duct from the vas deferens, they are not able to enter. All right. So the one possibility could be that there is ejaculatory duct obstruction. The one possibility, glaring possibility, could be that there is ejaculatory duct obstruction. This is the first possibility. The second possibility could be that the seminal vesicles are absent. The seminal vesicles are absent altogether. And this condition where the seminal vesicles are absent is congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens. We will see that the seminal vesicles are also absent and the vas deferens are also absent. So the second possibility could be congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens. In this situation, the seminal vesicles, they are also absent. The seminal vesicles, they are also absent. These are the two possibilities. How to differentiate? How to differentiate now? I've given you the two possibilities. Can you tell me how to differentiate now? I've given you the two possibilities. Can you tell me how to differentiate? Anybody? Whenever there is a semen report showing azoospermia, low volume ejaculate, acidic pH, absent fructose, these are the two immediate possibilities that come to mind. How can we differentiate between the two conditions? Well, if it's an ejaculatory duct obstruction, the tract above the obstruction will be dilated. The tract above the obstruction will be dilated, right? So in ejaculatory duct obstruction, what do we see? We see that the seminal vesicles, they are dilated. And in CBAVD, what do we see? We see that the seminal vesicles are absent. And this you can confirm on ultrasound. We can even palpate for the vas deferens above the scrotum and in the inguinal canal. Okay. So in a congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, what is going to happen? We will be not be able to palpate. We are not able to palpate the vas deferens digitally. It is possible to palpate the vas deferens digitally above the scrotum and in the inguinal canal. So we will not be able to palpate that, and we can confirm on ultrasound. And on ultrasound, if we are seeing that the seminal vesicles are dilated, that means it is ejaculatory duct obstruction. So these are the first two possibilities that come to mind. Let's say that we have ruled out ejaculatory duct obstruction. This is not there. Let's say we have also ruled out congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens, this is also not there. Then a third possibility could be, there's also a third possibility. The third possibility could be a retrograde ejaculation. Retrograde ejaculation. What is retrograde ejaculation? Retrograde ejaculation means that during ejaculation, the ejaculate, instead of coming out from the penile urethra outside, actually goes back into the bladder. So retrograde ejaculation into the urinary bladder could be the third possibility which we need to look into. Okay, so please remember, when the semen report parameters are given to you as such, there are three possibilities. You will first rule out first and second possibilities, which are more common. If they are not found, then we'll start thinking whether it is a retrograde ejaculation or not. Okay, so this is about the evaluation of semen reports. Now, what do we do? Now, Afshan, you were asking, what do we do when these semen reports are abnormal? Now, before that, let's just talk about these important questions which have been asked in the past in the NEET PG examination. Let's figure them out. Which of the following is true for obstructive azoospermia? Obstructive azoospermia. Azoospermia, like I told you, can be obstructive or could be non-obstructive. In non-obstructive azoospermia, there are going to be testicular and the pre-testicular causes of azoospermia. In obstructive causes, we are going to have the post-testicular causes or disorders in sperm transport are going to be there. So very good, obstructive azoospermia, the normal hormone levels are going to be there. Normal hormone levels, all hormones are going to be normal. All right. And in non-obstructive azoospermia, if it is testicular cause, if it's gonadal failure, then the testosterone is decreased and consequently the FSH is increased. If it's a hypothalamic or a pituitary cause for this non-obstructive azoospermia, pre-testicular cause, then the FSH is decreased and the testosterone is also decreased consequently. All right. Now let's move on to the next question. Semen analysis of a male during infertility workup showed low semen value, low volume semen, absence of sperms and absence of fructose. What is the most probable diagnosis out of the options given below? Prostatic infection. In prostatic infection, there is going to be acidic pH. I agree. Prostatic infection will lead to acidic pH. I agree. But why low volume will be there? There will not be low volume there. Why absence of sperm should be there in prostatic infection? Mumps or coitus, I agree. If the mumps or coitus has taken place and it has led to gonadal failure, there will be absence of sperms. I agree. But why should there be low volume semen? Why should there be absence of fructose? If there is a block in ejaculatory duct, then that is the most probable diagnosis. So whenever there is low volume semen, absence of sperms, absence of fructose, think about block in ejaculatory duct or congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens as the potential likely causes in that scenario. Okay, clear. So Rashmi and Afshan rightly said, Subhash also rightly answered. Let's have a look at the next question. In azoospermia, the diagnostic test which can distinguish between testicular failure and obstruction of vas deferens is what? Now, this is a slightly tricky question. Let's see who gets it right. Azoospermia, what is the diagnostic test which can distinguish between testicular failure and obstruction of vas deferens? And I can feel that the most of the times we have doubts whether it is estimation of FSH level or whether it is estimation of testosterone level. In obstruction of vas deferens, the testosterone is going to be normal. In testicular failure, the testosterone is going to be decreased. So we are tempted to say estimation of testosterone level. But please remember that testosterone levels are also going to be decreased in hypothalamic and pituitary cause. So testosterone levels are also decreased in hypothalamic or pituitary causes of non-obstructive azoospermia. So therefore, better answer to choose is estimation of FSH level. Better answer to choose is estimation of FSH level, because only in testicular failure is FSH going to be increased. FSH is increased only in cases of testicular failure. So that is a better answer to choose. Okay, Yash, do you get why I chose FSH level as the answer? Ideally, in ideal circumstances, that means in routine clinical circumstances, I will have both FSH and testosterone levels. I will have a report of both testosterone and FSH levels to come to the diagnosis evaluating this azoospermic male. I won't have just the FSH level or I won't have just the testosterone level. I will perform both the hormone tests and then make a decision. But if you have to choose, that's how NEET PG questions, that's how multiple choice questions sometimes trick you, right? You have to choose the single best answer, and therefore I'm choosing FSH level as the answer here, because I told you that testosterone can be decreased even in hypothalamic or pituitary cause. They are particularly asking you how to differentiate between testicular failure and obstruction. That's why I'm choosing estimation of FSH level as the better choice of answer here. Supposing this would have been something else, absolutely, this option would not have been there, then I would have chosen estimation of testosterone level as the answer. Okay, clear? Now let's move ahead and see the next question. An infertile male on evaluation was found to have immotile sperms on semen analysis. He also suffers from recurrent sinus infections and bronchiectasis. What is the likely cause? A classic syndrome here. This is straight away textbook question from the book, exactly picked up. Cartagener syndrome. Yes, so Cartagener syndrome is what we call as primary ciliary dyskinesia. Primary ciliary dyskinesia. So the cilia are defective. They are immotile cilia, right? It is also called as immotile cilia syndrome. So the cilia in the respiratory tract, they are also affected. And when the cilia in the respiratory tract are affected, the cilia helps us to clear out secretions and debris from the respiratory tract, right? So that's why male with Cartagener syndrome also suffer from recurrent sinus tract infections and bronchiectasis because of repeated lung infections as well, right? So that's your clear textbook question here. So please remember that as well. All right. Now, another important thing I want to ask you, let's have a look at the other options also. We've talked about congenital bilateral absence of vas deferens Klinefelter syndrome. My question is to you people is, can Kallmann syndrome lead to male infertility? Kallmann syndrome we talked about in female delayed puberty and all those things. Can Kallmann syndrome lead to male infertility? What do you think? Yes or no? Could you identify a male with Kallmann syndrome? Is it possible to have a male with Kallmann syndrome? Yes or no? Rare, but a possibility. Yes or no? Could a male have Kallmann syndrome? Yes. Subhash is now getting my gist. When I ask you questions in this trick manner, the answer is always what I'm trying to hint at. Yes, Kallmann syndrome can also affect the males. Males can also be affected by Kallmann syndrome. Okay, now this Kallmann syndrome is a genetic abnormality where the GnRH secreting neurons are not present in the hypothalamus. There is absence of GnRH secreting neurons in the hypothalamus. All right. So if the GnRH is not only there, then it leads to gonadal failure consequently. No GnRH, no anterior-pituitary gonadotropins, no stimulation of the gonads, right? Now this Kallmann syndrome is mostly an autosomal recessive disorder. It is an autosomal recessive disorder. It is a sex-linked disorder. It is a sex-linked disorder. Okay, the gene is transmitted on the X chromosome. So males can also be affected. So please do not think that only the females can get affected. The males can also get affected. It can be transmitted by various patterns, mostly sex-linked. There has been seen autosomal recessive mode of transmission is also seen, but mostly it is sex-linked. So even the males can be affected. So if the question was that there is an infertile male, if the question was there is an infertile male with decreased FSH and decreased testosterone levels and there is anosmia, right, and there is azoospermia, if this is the clinical profile that's given to you, what's your answer then in that circumstance? Then your answer is Kallmann syndrome. Then your answer is Kallmann syndrome likely. Okay, so infertile male, FSH and testosterone levels low, anosmia and azoospermia. Think of Kallmann syndrome as the possibility. Okay. Now let's see the next question. Okay, I have already answered this question actually. A young male being evaluated for infertility found to have absence of sperms in his semen. Further evaluation, serum testosterone, FSH levels are also low. Lack of sense of smell, known to have red-green color blindness. Most probable diagnosis is Kallmann syndrome. So I've already given you the explanation of this question in the previous slide. Now, let's move forward and talk about management of azoospermia or severe oligospermia. What if there is azoospermia or severe oligospermia? See, you have the semen sample report in front of you. You have the report saying that there is absolutely no sperm or absolutely low sperm concentration. What do you do? We identify the cause. Okay, we've identified the cause. Maybe it's gonadal failure, maybe it's pituitary or hypothalamic cause, maybe it's obstructive or whatever it is. Nowadays in current scenarios with increasing techniques and increasing advancement in in vitro fertilization techniques, the goal is to extract the sperms. Remember that the goal is to extract the sperm from wherever we can. So if there is obstructive azoospermia, we can extract the sperms from the epididymis. So if there is obstruction along the vas deferens or the ejaculatory duct or anywhere along, we can extract the sperms from above the obstruction, isn't it? So we can extract the sperms from the epididymis. So we can go for sperm extraction techniques like microsurgical epididymal sperm aspiration or percutaneous epididymal sperm aspiration. So in percutaneous, a needle is inserted into the epididymis percutaneously and aspiration is done. In microsurgical epididymal sperm aspiration, we give a small incision over the scrotum and we give a small incision over the epididymis, and from there then we go for the microsurgical epididymal sperm aspiration, right? And if the cause of the azoospermia is non-obstructive, then we have the option of extracting sperms from the testes itself. from the testes itself. So we can go for testicular sperm extraction, or we can also go for testicular sperm aspiration. Okay, so when we go for aspiration, it's a percutaneous insertion of a needle. When we go for extraction, incision is given over the scrotum, incision is given, a small incision given over the testes. We go directly inside the spermatogenic tubules where the spermatogenesis is taking place, and from there we extract sperms. Now these are all microsurgical techniques. Okay, these are all microsurgical techniques which are done utilizing the microscopic principles. Okay, so we can extract these sperms. Now once we have extracted these sperms, what do we do next? Surgically retrieve sperms, what do we do next? Afshan, I'm so glad, very rightly said ICSI. What is ICSI now? ICSI stands for intracytoplasmic sperm injection. Intracytoplasmic sperm injection. So mind you, look how we began with. We began with azoospermia. We began with severe oligospermia, right? And we have managed to extract some surgically retrieved sperms. We've managed to extract some sperms. We'll not get a good sperm count out of that surgical extraction. We'll have limited number of sperms which we are able to extract. And the motility of these sperms is not normal. The motility of these sperms is not adequate. Why? Because they have been, maybe we have extracted them from the testes, especially if we have extracted them from the testes, especially if we have done a testicular extraction, then we get immotile sperms, isn't it? The motility of the sperms is gained in the epididymis. If we have taken from the testes, they are immotile. If they are immotile, then they cannot penetrate inside the egg on their own. So we do a procedure which is called as ICSI. ICSI is the latest technique under in vitro fertilization. So we take an egg. Okay, we take an egg and a sperm is injected into the oocyte directly under microscope. A single sperm is injected into the oocyte by a small, a needle which is as thin as the hair, as thin as a single hair strand. This is all done under a microscope. This procedure is called as ICSI, right? So in cases of azoospermia, severe oligospermia, these men maybe a decade or two decades ago did not have a chance of having an offspring. Now there is a new hope for them, and the hope comes from the advancement in technologies of ICSI. So ICSI can be offered as a treatment protocol for women suffering from azoospermia or severe oligospermia. Then what do we do in case of mild semen abnormality? Mild semen abnormality. Now Afshan, here's your question. What if the semen abnormality is not so severe as to categorize it as azoospermia or azoospermia or severe oligospermia? So it could be a mild oligospermia, it could be only asthenospermia, that is decreased motility, it could be some increase in abnormal morphology, abnormal morphology could be there. So there could be mild degrees of semen abnormality, maybe a single abnormality or a combination of multiple abnormalities, but only in the mild category, not severe azoospermia, not azoospermia or severe oligospermia. Then the treatment is intrauterine insemination. See, the sperms, if you tell me that there is only asthenospermia, there is decreased motility. Because there is decreased motility, the sperms are not able to climb up the cervix, they are not able to climb up the uterus, they are not able to reach the fallopian tubes because, their motility is decreased or their count is low, so much of the sperms, they are lost out into the outside, they leak, some semen leaks from the vagina, some sperms they are left in the vagina, some sperms they are left in the uterine tract and few manage to reach the fallopian tube. So if the degrees of abnormality is only mild or a single abnormality is there, we do IUI, intrauterine insemination. What is this procedure? We are deciding, okay, sperms, maybe you have some problem, some abnormality, mild only. Let me help you a little bit. Let me go halfway for you. Let me take you and put you inside the uterine cavity. This is called as intrauterine insemination. So you can see here we have a semen sample in this syringe. We have a semen sample in this syringe, okay? And this semen sample is not the semen sample you can take directly from the male and say, okay. No, you have to have a sperm preparation. You have to have a prepped semen sample. A prepped semen sample and washed semen sample. You want a prepped and a washed semen sample. So that is called as sperm preparation. Now this sperm preparation can be done by various methods like the swim up method, the density gradient method, or glass wool filtration. All right. The logic of these sperm preparation methods is all the same. The best sperms are chosen. Among the lot, the best ones are chosen. How do we choose the best ones? The best looking ones, the best performing ones, the most motile ones. So there is one method which is called as the simplest method. I will show you to give you the concept behind it. So in the swim up method, what we do is we take the semen sample. This is the semen sample here in the test tube. Okay, we fill it up with a culture media. All right. And then we centrifuge this tube. We centrifuge it. When we do that, the motile sperms, the naturally better motile sperms, they are going to swim up by virtue of their own motility. So I'm going to get a collection here of sperms, and this collection of sperms are the ones which are the most motile ones. These are the most motile sperms which I'm going to collect. So this is one method, the simplest concept method. So swim up method. In the exams, they ask you which is the best method. So swim up is the simplest. Glass wool filtration is of course the best method. This is the newest method. This is the second best method. So best method, glass wool filtration, if that's in your option. Otherwise, second best method is the density gradient method. So yes, when they frame that question in the examination, and if they have given you density gradient method, that's your best method. If glass wool filtration is given in the option, then that's your best method for sperm preparation. Once we have prepared the sperm semen, we are going to take 0.5 ml of this semen sample and inject it into the uterus by using a very thin cannula, which is malleable and ductile. So it will go very smoothly inside and we'll deposit the semen sample here. Now, after this, the rest of the job, the rest of the traveling in the fallopian tube, the fertilization and everything, the sperms will have to do it for themselves. So Afshan, okay, so your question was severe asthenospermia. Severe asthenospermia is going to be there. That means you're trying to tell me severe, there is no criteria for severe asthenospermia. Okay, so there is a total criteria of motile, at least 32% should be motile. That would be normal motility, 32% with progressive motility. If I ask you when do I call it as severely immotile, there's no criteria for that. Okay, so we try to do few cycles of intrauterine insemination if the count is good but the motility is on the lesser side. Okay, I'm talking about the practical aspects. We'd have no criteria to call it as severe asthenospermia all by itself. So we can try intrauterine insemination for some time, for few cycles. The other important thing that I want to tell you is, what if there is a normal sperm concentration and there is absolutely immotile sperms? The condition that you're probably asking is, what if there is absolutely immotile sperms? I think that is a better question to ask, Afsan, that what if there are immotile sperms in the sample, but the count is normal, but the concentration is okay and the immotile sperms are there. Now, under the microscope, if the sperm looks immotile to me, I don't know if it's dead or immotile. Plain simple as that. I have to find out if it is dead. I have to find out if these immotile sperms, which are not moving under the microscope, are they immotile or are they dead to begin with? I have to find out if they are actually dead. So this is one indication to do the sperm vitality studies. There are sperm vitality studies also where we will further analyze the semen sample, further analyze the sperms to see if they are dead sperms or they're actually immotile sperms only. Okay, so that is something that we need to do next if there are absolutely immotile sperms and the concentration is okay. Now, what is the final prepped sample? When we get this final prepped sample, this final prepped sample that we have got, if the total motile sperm count in the final sperm count, final prepped sample is more than 10 million, and if the normal morphology is more than 14%, that is when the best results are achieved. Best results of IUI are achieved if at least the final motile sperm count in the prepped sample is 10 million, at least 10 million, and the normal morphological forms in the final prepped sample is at least 14%. So I think there goes your answer. There goes your answer. There is no cutoff criteria under which we can say that I should give intrauterine insemination or I should try ICSI instead. It's a hit and trial method. It has been seen that if in the final prepped sample, these are the sperm count, motile sperm count, and 14% are normal morphology, then the best results of IUI are achieved. Doesn't mean, let me give you a scenario. If the total motile sperm count is 8 million instead of 10 million, if the normal morphology is 10% instead of 14%, and I have that sample in front of me, what will I say? Let me not inseminate it because best results will not be achieved. I will still go ahead with the intrauterine insemination and see if it works, isn't it? And see if it works. All right. So whenever there is mild semen abnormality of Shan, we go ahead and try intrauterine insemination, yes, but we also know that the best results are achieved when a minimum criteria of the total motile sperm count and normal morphology is met in the final prepped sample. Doesn't mean that if it's less than that, we should not do insemination at all. We can do, but then the results may be lesser. Okay, the results may be lesser. We might not be 100% successful, but even 1% successful chance, good enough. You know, let's take that chance. Why not? Isn't it? Now let's talk about the indications of IUI. What are the indications of IUI? Okay, direct questions asked in the exams about the indications of IUI versus indications of IVF. When will you prefer to do IUI and when will you prefer to do IVF? That's the main distinction that we have to make. All right. Now, what are the indications? Whenever there is mild male factor infertility, that is one of the most common indications for IUI. This we've discussed in the previous slide. If there is retrograde ejaculation, if a male is ejaculating inside the urinary bladder, okay, then we can also do IUI because see, whenever we want to bypass the physical act of coitus, okay, IUI helps us to bypass the physical act of coitus on sex and intercourse. So when you want to bypass that, then IUI becomes a very good alternative treatment method. So if a male is suffering from retrograde ejaculation, we can use IUI. If he's having sexual dysfunction, premature ejaculation or IVF, or sorry, not premature ejaculation, if he's having impotence, sexual dysfunction like impotence or ejaculatory dysfunctions he's suffering from. These are the reasons where IUI comes in very handy as a procedure. Then there could be unexplained infertility. Remember in the female section and remember when I discussed about the female infertility and evaluation, I told you that in unexplained infertility, we've not evaluated for the cervical factor. Why? Because we are anyways going to use intrauterine insemination as the treatment protocol. And then we are going to bypass the cervix anyways. So for unexplained infertility, we begin the treatment with IUI. Cervical factor infertility is another indication for IUI. If we are using a donor sperm, we can also use donor sperm for IUI. Let's say the male has such severe azoospermia and absolutely no sperms have been extracted from the male partner. Then one way to achieve fertility for that couple is use a donor sperm. So if you're using a donor sperm, then we can do IUI along with that donor sperm, right? So these are some of the indications in routine clinical practice which are used for IUI, intrauterine insemination. And what are the indications for IVF? Yes, one by one, I need the indications for IVF. What is the most important indication for in vitro fertilization? What is in vitro fertilization? We extract eggs from the mother, right? So we have these eggs here. Let's say these are the eggs, pellets. And we take the semen from the partner, deposit it around the egg. This semen pellet contains a number of sperms. A number of sperms are there. So hundreds of sperms surrounding a single egg in a petri dish, left to fertilize in the lab, and we'll get a zygote in the lab, and then the zygote will be taken and implanted inside and transferred inside the uterus. So we will get an embryo after fertilization, and then the embryo will be transferred to the uterine cavity. This procedure is called as ET, embryo transfer. Okay, this fertilization is achieved in the lab. This procedure is what we call as conventional IVF. Why am I calling it conventional IVF? For over decades, we had this conventional IVF. But over the last 20 to 30 years, we have another form of IVF, which is ICSI. So there's one form of IVF, which is conventional IVF. Another form of IVF is ICSI, where instead of, sperms in this situation have to fertilize on their own. They're just kept together in the petri dish. In ICSI, single sperm is injected into the cytoplasm of the oocyte. So that is done by ourselves. We are causing that penetration of the sperm into the oocyte. So that is called as ICSI. So there are two ways to do IVF in the current scenarios: conventional IVF and ICSI. So Dr. Musarrat is rightly saying tubal factor. This is one of the first indications of IVF. When IVF was evolving, it was initially developed as a procedure for tubal factor infertility. Fertility, the fertilization happens in the tube. If the tubes are blocked, if the tubes are damaged and destroyed, then we resort to IVF directly. Second is severe male factor infertility. Now, with the advent of ICSI, we can go for IVF as well, even in cases with severe male factor infertility. Let's say if there was a mild male factor infertility, okay? We tried IUI for multiple cycles. Let's say we've tried IUI for 3 cycles and still there is no pregnancy. This will be called as treatment failure. So whenever there is treatment failure, we can go to IVF. We can go to IVF as the next step. Let's say that we were trying ovulation induction in a woman with PCOS. We tried it for 3 to 6 cycles. It didn't work. We tried ovulation induction plus IUI. Okay, it didn't work. We tried it for 3 to 6 months. So we wasted how much? We wasted almost a year in these procedures. It doesn't work. We can go to IVF as the next treatment protocol. So whenever there is treatment failure, The third indication is treatment failure. Whenever there is treatment failure, we can go to IVF. Unexplained infertility. Whenever there is unexplained infertility, we begin the treatment with ovulation induction plus IUI is the treatment that we begin with. We begin with ovulation induction and IUI. If that fails, we can go to IVF. We can go ahead and do IVF. Excuse me. All right. And then the next indication is IVF with a donor oocyte. IVF with a donor oocyte. Supposing there's a woman who is 40 years of age or 45 years of age and she wants to conceive and her ovarian reserve is very low. We tried IVF in her but it failed, right? Then she can use a donor oocyte from a young healthy donor. Then we can do IVF along with a donor oocyte also. IVF with surrogacy. Supposing the woman has Asherman syndrome. Absolutely fibrosis of the uterine cavity. You tried correcting that. You tried surgical adhesolysis and everything, but it didn't work. All right. Then what you can do, you can tell her now you cannot conceive on your own. Let's take your eggs and your partner's sperm and have a zygote and then use a surrogate mother. So IVF with surrogacy is also an option. And another indication of IVF is IVF with pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. Now, this is used in circumstances like, for example, there is any genetic disorder. And both the male and the female partner are carriers, okay, known carriers. And then they don't want their offspring to suffer from that disease. Then we can do pre-implantation genetic diagnosis because we are getting the embryo in the lab. So when we are getting the embryo in the lab, we can test that embryo genetically. Pre-implantation, before implantation, we can test an embryo in the lab and then we can have the report whether the embryo is suffering from that genetic disorder or not. If the embryo is suffering from the genetic disorder, we keep it aside, we don't use that embryo. And the healthy embryos can be transferred to the uterine cavity of the woman. So IVF can be done along with pre-implantation genetic diagnosis also. So in current scenarios, these are the common indications of performing IVF. Tubal factor, severe male factor, treatment failure, unexplained infertility. I agree that we will at least begin with the ovulation induction plus IUI in a case of unexplained infertility. But if it fails, then we have to go to IVF. We will have to resort to IVF then in that case. Okay. Now, Dr. Musarrat, you want your question is... okay, Subhash, I'll say Subhash's see here. Are there any criteria to say mild and severe male factor? Subhash, to say mild and severe male factor. Okay, very good question. I'll tell you the criteria vary from country to country. The criteria vary from center to center, but a general accepted criteria. I'll have to erase this a little bit. Just let me erase this a little bit. Okay, so the criteria which is generally accepted, it can vary from country to country, it can vary from center to center, from setup to setup, but usually a general agreement on this is achieved that what we call a severe male factor is the concentration, sperm concentration less than 5 million per ml, right? And a morphology which is less than 4%, normal morphological forms which are less than 4%, and motility which is less than 5%. Motility which is less than 5%. Okay, so these are the general agreed terms on what we call as a severe male factor. Yes, Adnan has rightly answered it for you, Vaise. And Dr. Musarrat, you want to know for selection of Y sperm and make baby ICSI? Matlab, I am not understanding your question. Musarrat, can you just rephrase your question? I don't understand what you're trying to ask here. Can you try rephrasing your question, please, Musarrat? I'm waiting, Musarrat, while you try to rephrase your question, while I have another important point to tell you is that whenever we find a male with the severe oligospermia or azoospermia and there is presence of Y chromosome microdeletions. Presence of Y chromosome microdeletion. So whenever there is a male with gonadal failure, which is responsible for causing severe oligo and azoospermia, and you found that that male is suffering from Y chromosome microdeletions, you can ask me, and you didn't ask me that, can we subject these males to ICSI or not? We can, but the caveat is that we have to counsel that if the male partner, male parent is carrying Y chromosome microdeletions, then these microdeletions are transmitted to the offspring. Okay, so then there is chances that the male offspring of that male partner can also turn out to be infertile in the future. So this has to be told to the male before that male decides to use his own sperm to achieve a pregnancy. So it is important to counsel. You have to counsel the couple that these Y chromosome deletions, can be transmitted to the male offspring. Okay, that's why it is important to test for Y chromosome microdeletions. Alright, because they are transmitted from the male partner to the male offspring. Okay, Dr. Musarrat, some people do ICSI to conceive with a male baby. Not here in India, we have very strict laws as far as sex selection is considered. So I have not been exposed to that scenario clinically ever. So in our country, the laws are very strict against sex determination before the child is born, or even sex selection in any form in IVF. I think, yeah, that is a potential, maybe a potentiality that has been explored in other countries. I'm not aware of that. But yes, me practicing in India, I've not been exposed to this scenario where IVF has been done or ICSI has been done. ICSI has been done to choose a male offspring. And nowadays, you know, a lot of ethical issues also arise, and now there is a concept of having designer babies also, you know, people are working towards that, where you can choose what genes you can or cannot transmit to your offspring. I mean, it's all under wraps as of now. It's all experimental. It is all potential avenues. But as of now, I have not been exposed to those scenarios. Okay, Musarrat? So personally, I'm not aware if that is being done or not. It's not being done in our country as of yet. Okay, that's something that our country's laws are particularly, we have got very stringent laws covering, you know, whom can we give IVF, what can we do under IVF. So it's a regulated industry, if I may use the word, right? We have legal implications to answer to. So that is something that we do not do or condone as far as in our countries are concerned. So I can say that country to country wise also, you know, various other indication may be added to this list. Okay. So any more questions? Otherwise, I'll end the session now. So those of you who subscribe to the Plus platform can find a capsule course in gynae oncology where I've discussed the important gynae cancers, a capsule course on high-risk pregnancy where all high-risk pregnancy has been discussed, and special classes which are free classes. You can check them out as well. For that, you don't need to subscribe, but you can check out the special classes. These are free, where I've discussed previous year questions from gynecology, previous year recent exam questions from obstetrics, figure-based questions and flashcards have been discussed in two sessions. So you can check that out also on the special class platform. All right. And yes, friends, subscribe. You can use my code SHONALI and get a 10% discount on your subscription package as well if you use this code. So thank you so much for watching. Have a good day, and I'll see you tomorrow same time at 4 p.m. Thank you so much.